Hello children, welcome to another session of Geography Class 10 Transportation. So before we commence with the chapter, a quick look at what we have learnt earlier in the earlier sessions. Okay, in our last session we had studied about railways. The first railway when it was introduced and by whom it was introduced, by the Britishers in the year 1853 between Mumbai and Thane. At present, we had learnt that the railways are the largest and the busiest rail network of the world, and every day it is transporting over 18 million of passengers and more than 2 million tons of freight daily. Apart from that, we had also studied that the railway system was divided into 17 zones with their respective headquarters. We had studied about the track system, that is the width of the track of the Indian Railways, and we found that there were three, it was divided into three categories: the broad gauge, the meter gauge, the narrow gauge. Broad gauge was the rails between the rails was 1.67 meters, and it connected all the major cities and ports of India. Then the meter gauge, the distance between the rail was 1 meter, and it accounted for 7,180 kilometers throughout the nation. Narrow gauge was the distance between the rail was 0.762 to and at places 0.610, and it was only confined to the hilly regions. We had studied about the various advantages of railways, the various disadvantages of railways. About the air transport, we had studied that it started between Allahabad and Naini in the year 1911, and the Airports Authority of India came into existence in 1st April 1995. Now, till then, there were two major authorities, that is the National Airports Authority and the International Airports Authority, who was looking after the flights in India. Now, the air transport in India was managed by two corporations, Air India and Indian Airlines. And it was the government had ended the policy of Indian Airlines, Air India, and it had adopted the open sky policy. And under this liberalization scheme, the Indian skies consumers were getting cheap and better services. The private firms, the private companies like the Jetline Airways, the Spice Limited, the Kingfisher Airways, Go Airways, they were invited, and the transportation, air transportation became cheap and of better quality. Apart from that, we had also studied about the Pawan Hans Helicopters Limited and how it was providing helicopter support services to the oil sector, offshore exploration, and it was also operating in the hilly and inaccessible areas and making available charter flights for promotion of tourism. We had studied about the airways, the advantages and disadvantages of airways. So, today we are going to study about water transport in India. So, India is endowed, so we just focus on water transport, and we come to know that India is endowed with extensive network of waterways in the form of rivers, canals, backwaters, creek, and a long coastline accessible through seas and oceans. So water transport can be divided into two categories: inland waterways and oceanic waterways. Now children, in our text we are going to just focus on the Indian waterways, that is more in our syllabus. So the Indian waterways include rivers, canals, black waters and creeks which are deep enough to allow the ships and boats to navigate safely. These waterways These waterways must also be free of barriers such as waterfalls and rapids. However, the rivers of Peninsula India are not ideal for navigation. First, these rivers are seasonal and they are rain-fed. Secondly, these rivers are comparatively shorter than the northern rivers. And thirdly, the rivers are marked by a number of waterfalls. Now, children, this is very, very important and you need to underline this. Many often questions is asked why the waterways in the peninsular region is not navigable in comparison to the waterways of the northern India. And your answer is of 3 points. You can write these 3 points. Firstly, the rivers are seasonal rain-fed. That means that they depend on rainfall. Secondly, these rivers are shorter, which we can easily see. They are much shorter than the northern rivers. Thirdly, they are marked by a number of waterfalls. Now, it is a plateau region. We understand that the southern South India is a plateau region. As such, the topography is undulating. There are waterfalls and rapids on the way of these rivers. And as such, navigation is not possible. Then, India has about 14,500 of the navigable waterways, out of which 3,700 kilometers of river and 4,300 kilometers of canals are navigable. Freight transportation by waterways is highly underutilized in India compared to the other larger countries. Then, cargo transportation is in an organized manner is confined to a few waterways in Goa, West Bengal, Assam and Kerala. Inland Waterways Authority, please underline, just like we had the National Highway Authority of India, for the inland waterways, we have this authority, Inland Waterway Authority of India, which is a statutory authority in charge of waterways in India. Now, what is the function of this IWAI? And its function is building necessary infrastructure in these waterways. So, whatever necessary infrastructure is required is built by them. Surveying the economic feasibility of new projects. So, any new projects which they are undertaking, they'll see the economic possibility of such projects, and it is also into administration and regulation of the ships. Now, the Inland Waterway Authority have declared the 5 inland waterways as the national waterways. Now, before we do, we study about these, a quick look at this green box, which tells us that the river Ganga is navigable from its mouth up to Allahabad. Now, why is it only this area, that is from where the river ends and up to Allahabad, it is navigable? So, the reasons are that Ganga is a perennial and snow-fed by monsoon rain, so it is a perennial river also, that is, it is snow fed and also by the monsoon rains also is giving water and melting of the snow. So, and during the dry season, it is joined by Yamuna, Son, Ram Ganga, Gomti, Ghagra, Gandak, Kosi, so many tributaries are joining the river, and the river has a depth. It is very wide and very deep, and the slope of the Ganga is gradual. The river bed is free of stones and silt. This is a very important, the third point is very important. Unlike the peninsular rivers, the river Ganga has a gradual slope and is free from any stones and silt. Okay, now back to the Inland Water Authorities and why it is considered, it has declared the five inland waterways in India, out of which we are only going to do the three main ones. Now, the first one being the National Highway Authority, National Waterway number 1. It comprises of Ganga, Bhagirathi, Hooghly river system, and which connects Haldia, Kolkata, Farakka, Munger, Patna, Varanasi and Allahabad. So these are the main cities which are covered by the National Waterway number 1, and the main connecting cities are your Haldia and Allahabad. Haldia in West Bengal and Allahabad in Uttar Pradesh. These are the main connecting cities, and this National Waterway 1 is one of the largest inland waterways. Okay. Next we come to the National Waterway 2, and this comprises of the river Brahmaputra. Please underline that it comprises of the river Brahmaputra, and it is connecting Dhubri, Pandu, Tezpur, Nemati. You can just write, remember the two main names which it is connecting, and in that case you will remember that the Brahmaputra river between Sadhya and Dhubri. Please underline or write it down. Between Sadhya, S-A-D-Y-A, and Dhubri, it is connecting, and it is called the National Waterway 2. A question has been asked based on this. This is entirely in the northeast, and it is called the National Waterway 2. Now, the third one is the National Waterway 3, which runs from Kolam to Kottapuram in Kerala. Now it is a canal called the West Coast Canal, and it is one of the most navigable and tourism potential area in India. Okay, so we are only doing the three main ones. Now we come to the oceanic waterways, and under the we do not have the oceanic waterways in our syllabus. If you check the scope of the syllabus, we will find that only it confines to your, it is confining to the waterways and the advantages and disadvantages, since boats are not mentioned. And last year that notice also came from the council that the ports questions based on the ports will not be asked. So we are leaving the oceanic waterways, and we straight away come to the advantages and disadvantages of waterways. Now, amongst the advantages, it is the cheapest means of transport. So very important, children, that the waterways is the cheapest means of transport, even cheaper than the railways, it is said. So whenever about, when you are writing about the cheapest, then you please mention the waterway is the cheapest. It is the most suitable for carrying heavy and bulky material. Though we are carrying heavy and bulky material in railways, but much bulkier material can be carried in the waterways. So when we are mentioning about heavy and bulky material, then it is always waterways. Next, it is fuel efficient and eco-friendly in nature. Both these points are important. It is fuel efficient, eco-friendly, it does not pollute the environment much. Again, it is comfortable, lot of space is there, many facilities are there. Then water transport is safe and has less traffic in comparison to the road and air transport. It has less traffic in compared to the road and water transport. Now, another thing that can be added is that about these water transport is that we have mentioned that it is eco-friendly. We have mentioned about that it is able to carry heavy and bulky goods. It needs less fuel. As such, it's it saves fuel. And please add to it, to the advantages, that the maintenance cost of a waterway is also very negligible. The maintenance cost of the waterway is very negligible. Please add this point to your advantages of waterways. Now we come to the disadvantages of waterways. Like the first point says, it depends on weather conditions. So I disapprove this point. Please do not mention this point, as we are only dealing with the inland waterways and the weather conditions are not very important for such, because tides are not much in the waterways, inland waterways, in the rivers, and not the weather conditions do not disturb much when it is only concerned with inland waterways. So do not mention the first point. Second point, it needs long traveling hours. It needs long traveling hours, which causes seasickness. Again, yes, it causes long traveling hours can be taken. Yes, this point can be taken. Then, water transport is limited to areas where the rivers are navigable and oceanic routes exist. Okay, where the rivers are navigable, this point can easily be taken. Because it is not accessible everywhere, only where the river is leading to, only those places can be accessed. Not everywhere, wherever we feel like, we cannot reach through waterways. So this is one of the disadvantages, that it needs long traveling hours, then in comparison to the other means of transport. And then it is only accessible to limited areas, that is also. Then, so these are the two, and it is slower, that means it takes long traveling hours. Okay, so these are the two points which can be taken as the disadvantages of waterways. Now with this we come to the end of the chapter, and there are some questions. Now these are the board questions which you can do. I'll attach this, a clearer picture of this along with this lecture, so that you can see these questions. Whichever questions you feel is a repetition, you may leave that. Otherwise, these questions are from your board questions and are quite easy. I'm sure you'll be able to do them. In case of any question or any query, you may ask. So with this, we come to the end of the session. We'll come with a new chapter. Are more questions based on, we will discuss the questions maybe, or whatever your queries are, in our next session. So thank you and have a nice day.